Welcome back. We'll start with NCERT Class 8 History, the fourth chapter that talks about tribals, Dikus and the vision of Golden Age. Now, this is the next story time that we would be beginning for the history lecture. And before we start with it, let's understand the meaning of the word Diku that's in the title. So, Diku was a term that was used to denote outsiders. Mainly, it was the term used to denote the Britishers and the British Raj. So, what is the basis for this chapter is how tribal movement gained momentum and how tribals started to raise their voice against the British Empire. So, it all started with Birsa Munda. Now, Birsa was one of the major leaders of the tribal movement and he belonged to Munda community or the Munda tribal group. There were two other common tribal groups in that area. Those were the Santhals and the Oraons. Both the Santhals and the Oraons and the followers of Munda followed Birsa wholeheartedly because they considered Birsa as a person who had miraculous powers and can cure diseases, can bring in prosperity in agriculture in that area. So slowly and gradually people developed a kind of strong faith in Birsa, who was basically Birsa Munda, and believe that he is a person who can revolutionize the living for a tribal and ultimately raise their voice against the British atrocities in India. So this is the area that is being marked for the presence of the various tribal groups. So you had the Munda tribe, Ho tribe, Santhal tribe, the Savara and the Kurku tribe. So the main tribes have been mentioned here, of which Munda tribe was among the main tribe which worked or which followed the path for rebellion against the British Empire. Now, what are the features of the tribal groups? If we talk about general tribal groups, we can say tribals have their unique customs and rituals. They live in their own groups in their villages. However, different tribes follow different strategies. For example, there are Khonds from Odisha who have a kind of community living. So what they do is they go to the forest and hunt together. They gather the meat collectively and then distribute it among the among all the members of the society. Similarly, you have Begas who live in central India, but for them dignity is very important. So they are happy to take out and gather fruits from the forest area, but they will never work as laborers into an industry. So that's another tribe which has their own dignity and their own way and strategy in which they live. Similarly, you have the Hajong tribe from Tripura, which migrated from Assam. And here, women take the equal responsibility as man in the workmanship. So there are different ideas through which people work. However, the two important classifications under tribal groups we can say were those who were settled and those who were nomadic or did not had a kind of settled life. So those who were settled were a kind of positive people for Britishers because it was easy to administer them. If there is any law that is being passed, the settled tribals were forced to follow those. However, if a person is moving from one village to another village to another village, if he is one day here, next day he is here, and the third day he is here, it's very difficult to pass laws and administer that person. So the tribal groups who were moving, who were nomadic, who did not have a kind of settled life structure, were very difficult to be governed by the Britishers. So Britishers had to face a huge problem to pass or follow rules so that the nomadic tribal groups could follow it. Now we'll talk about the Jhum cultivation. Jhum cultivation is also known as slash and burn cultivation, and it's a kind of agricultural practice which is commonly seen in the northeast India and the hilly tracts of India. Now what is this Jhum cultivation? Let's understand it with a simple demonstration here. So let's say you have three patches of land which are shown as rods here. Now what would happen? On the first patch of land, I'll grow the crop. Now this growing occurs in 3 years. So the first year is the process where you grow the crop. The second year is you have grown the crop, now you shift to hunting and other activities, and in the third year you try to supplement your diet with the forest products. Now, first year I grew my crops on this patch of land. Now, what happened is this patch of land is now exhausted. So, what I do is I move to the second patch of land and I leave this patch of land barren. Now, what would happen is the fly ash that is being left is rich in potash, so it is being sprinkled, and this soil which is left barren would regain fertility over the time. Now I am growing my crops on the second patch of land. Slowly and gradually what happens is this patch of land has exhausted and I move to the next patch of land. So what is this tribal group doing? This tribal group is basically moving from one region to another region, one patch of land to another patch of land. Now this tribe is growing in the third patch, and what happens during this time is this first patch of land which was left barren now has regained fertility. So if I grow the crops on this first patch of land again, it would become a kind of good cropping season, or there would be fertile soil that would be seen here. So what happens is this cycle rotates and you are back onto the first patch of land, and this is the way the Jhum cultivation work. Now Jhum cultivation was a major cultivation method in the tribal groups, and the most important thing to be noted in the Jhum cultivation was in other areas you sow the seeds, but here is you broadcast the seed. That means you just sprinkle it around, and the wherever the seeds go, the crops come up. So Jhum cultivation was highly followed. Again, a very important phenomena of the tribal group was they had a kind of strong kinship network. That means all the close members of the society lived together and practiced common beliefs. However, some of the people, specifically the Britishers, were trying to capture the empire of the tribals because they believed that these tribals could produce some of the really valuable forest produce which is not possible for a common man. So that was one of the reasons Britishers were very interested in capturing the regions around the forest area or the tribal area. Again, money lenders were a major problem to the tribals because they used to ask for loans, and tribals have to take the loans for meeting their local needs or the common needs, and finally what happened was they were struck with debt and poverty, and that became a kind of vicious cycle. So they took the loan 1 year, they were not able to repay it, so they went into a kind of debt, and that debt started to grow and grow over the years. So those were some of the common problems that were seen. Now next is some other activities that were seen. Bakarwals in Kashmir used to rear goats. You had Gaddis in Kullu who were shepherds. Labadis of Andhra Pradesh and one Gujjars of Punjab were both cattle herders. Now these are the kind of questions that are usually asked in the MCQs. So whenever you have a kind of multiple choice question, be ready with this. Which kind of tribe or which kind of pastoralists were found in which area and they were rearing which animal? So that's a kind of common matchless type of question that could be asked. Now as we said, Britishers were very interested in ruling the tribal areas and capturing the forest produce in the local area, because some of these forest produce was really really valuable, specifically in the European nations. So what they did was they asked the people to settle down, but the people who were practicing Jhum cultivation felt that it's not practical for them to settle down, and they somehow or the other went against the British rule and were not ready to settle down. Again, on the other hand, there were groups like Gonds and Santhals who believed that okay, we can settle down, and they accepted the British rule and they tried to settle down. However, as we said, you had the kind of Jhum cultivation season that occurs in 3 years or three processes, and each had a kind of monthly cycle that used to occur. So these are the months in the Hindi calendar. So it started with Chet, that's the first month where you clear the forest. Then in Baisakh, you fire the forest. During the month of Jet, you sow the seeds. From Ashar to Bhado, people work in the fields to grow crops. In the month of Kuar, the first fruits come up. In the month of Agan, the crops are ready. For the post month, you have winnowing and the festive season that comes up in the tribal region. And finally, during the Magh season, there is a shift to new bowers, that's new batch of lands, and hunting and gathering gains momentum. So you have the various tribes that you can see across India. So with this map, you have the Gaddis in Himachal Pradesh, you have one Gujjars in Punjab, Sabari in Bhil in Rajasthan, one Gujjar and Rathawa in Gujarat, you have Banjara in Maharashtra, Gond, Banjara and Bega in parts of Chhattisgarh and Madhya Pradesh, you have Santhal, Munda and Oraon. Now these three were the tribes who worshipped Birsa Munda and slowly and gradually became followers of Birsa Munda. Birsa Munda was one of the major leaders who led one of the revolts from the tribal group against the British Empire, and is very, very important. We'll talk about Birsa Munda as we move later in this section. And similarly, there were different parts of India that were practicing, that had different tribes and who were working against the British administration. Now, what was the impact of forest law? Britishers, when they entered India and they started to administer India, they felt that they should have the control over all the forest area. So what they said was, they declared all the forest area as the property of the state. Now, what they did was, of this patch of forest area, let's say they declared that this patch is a reserved forest. Now, a patch which is a reserved forest, here no tribal was allowed to enter, here no jhuming cultivation was allowed, and people were not allowed to move into the reserved forest and gather or collect the fruits. What happened? Why they explained or said that this region is a reserved forest? They wanted this region as a reserved forest because the logs and the trees from this forest went to make the sleeper coach in the railways, and that time railway was a kind of facility that was used only by the Britishers or the elite group. Now, once they declared that they had a reserved forest and no other person can enter that forest area, but over the time they realized that they are creating problem for themselves, because for cutting the logs, for making the sleepers, they required people, and these people were not allowed to enter the forest area. So what happened over the time? Over the time, the villagers were not interested in working with the Britishers, and they basically disobeyed and kind of did illegal practices which were against the British rule that time. So some of the major efforts were in Assam in 1906 in the led by Songram Sangama, and then you had the forest satyagraha in 1930s in the central province area. So what happened was, this was one of the activities that restricted or confined the Britishers. On the other hand, there were activities for silk production, and silk was that time considered a kind of valuable commodity in European market. So they wanted more and more tribals, mainly Santhals, to work in the silk industry. So they asked them to rear cocoons. However, when they were given in lieu of the rearing practices, they were given only 3 to 4 rupees for 1000 cocoons, and when these cocoons were sold into the market, the middleman or the person who was basically into the business earned 5 times the profit as he was giving to the tribal. So these were exported to Burdwan and Gaya for processing, and middlemen used to earn huge profit. This motivated the tribal groups to raise voice against the Britishers, because that time they realized that there are some undue benefits that are being taken from the tribal group by the Britishers. Similarly, the tribals also worked in the coal mines of Jharkhand, in the tea plantations of Assam, and ultimately the scenario was, most of the tribals were given very minimal wages and had to live a kind of miserable life. So what happened was, a kind of rebellion started against the British Empire. This rebellion was in the form of a kind of opposition for the existing taxation system, a kind of challenge for the existing laws, and exploitation by the moneylenders. So what happened was, there were various revolts that came up. So Kholes rebelled in 1831-32, Santhals rose their voice in 1855, Bastar rebellion took place in central India in 1910, and then you had the Worli revolt in Maharashtra in 1940 in the areas of Silvas and Vapi. So some of the major revolts were motivated by Birsa Munda, and Birsa Munda, as we said, was a person who was basically belonging to the Munda uprising and the Munda tribal group. However, he had followers later from Santhal and Oraon tribes. Recently, you had the Shaheed Gram Vikas Yojana that has been started in the Ulihattu village, which is the village of Birsa Munda in the Kunti district of Jharkhand. And this project by Jharkhand government aims to promote or develop the villages of the freedom fighters from India. So Birsa Munda, who was born in 1870, grew up in the forest areas of Bohonda, and he faced a kind of extreme poverty. However, he was well aware of the tales and the stories that were going on during that time. He heard about the time of Satyug, and he felt that Satyug should revive and should come back. So he went to local missionaries asking people, understanding facts. Then he went to Vaishnav groups. He understood the ideas of Vaishnavites. However, later on, he rejected everything. He rejected Christianity. He rejected Hinduism. He rejected what government practiced. And he created his own momentum for the tribal uprising to take place. And finally, what happened was, he stated that there should be three things that should work. First is, people should give up liquor. The villages should be clean, and they should stop believing in any kind of witchcraft. So these three ideas became his basis, and he said, with these three ideas we can have a vision of golden age or Satyug, and under that Satyug we would have a good life, we would have good trees, good orchards, we could practice cultivation for our dignified living, and it would be a kind of green and well-defined life. However, Britishers felt that this Birsa is a threat to their power. So what Britishers did was, they arrested Birsa in 1985 for rioting and jailed him for 2 years. When he came out of the jail, he urged people to destroy Ravan, and during that time he called Ravan as Dikus, or the outsiders or the Europeans who have infringed India, and he said that we should attack police stations, churches, raid the property of moneylenders and zamindars, and raise voice against the British Empire. So what slowly came up was a Munda Raj from the British Raj, and slowly and gradually he brought numerous people together to fight this struggle against the Britishers. Finally, in 1900 he died of cholera, but he had few of the landmarks that he created in the history. First was, he forced the Britishers to introduce a new law for the tribals, and that gave a good relief to the tribal group in the region. And also he expressed the views among the tribal that we will not bear any kind of injustice or any kind of atrocities on us, and in that case we will definitely lead a revolt. So that was the basic idea or the preachings of Birsa Munda that led to tribal uprisings in the different parts of India, starting from the regions of Jharkhand and Bihar during that time. So with this we cover chapter 4 in history. We'll be covering further lectures in history. So stay tuned, do join our channel, and if you have any doubts or suggestions, do leave those as comment below the video. Have a very good day ahead.